I'm Sami Assaf. I'm a professor of mathematics at the University of Southern California. When I was in eighth grade, I was in a geometry class that was an advanced geometry class, I suppose, at the time. And my teacher would make fun of me in a very kind way, in a good-natured way, because of the way I would write my proofs for geometry. And she would, you know, go after a test or something, she would go over, and this is, you know, this is what you were supposed to do. And then we have Sami, and she drew auxiliary lines. And, you know, I would sometimes go in these roundabout ways, and I'm like, well, the lines didn't look parallel. I needed the auxiliary lines to really make sure. A different teacher could have seen that as a negative and could have tried to make me conform to the way that everybody always does it. And I love that she celebrated that about me and helped me celebrate that about myself. And I think it kept me really enjoying mathematics when I was young, and kept me excited about those classes and about, you know, continuing in that direction. I went to a special high school called the North Carolina School of Science and Mathematics, and it was a STEM magnet school for bright kids in North Carolina. And I went there because I loved math and I just really, really enjoyed doing it. And I got there and I didn't like math anymore. I found it dull and uninspiring. And so when I went to college, I was a double major in great books and philosophy. And I loved it. But it was a little bit much of the same. And I was very annoyed that all of the books that I were on my reading list were all by dead white Europeans. And it's like every European man. And it's like there was no diversity in the spectrum. And it kind of rankled a little bit. And when I met my current husband when I was there, and he found out that I had been good at math, and he encouraged me to take linear algebra. So I hadn't taken college class in calculus or anything like that. And he's like, no, no, no. If you didn't like that, just go with linear algebra. I think you'll like it. And, you know, I gave it a shot and I loved it. And I got really into it again. And I remember we were diagonalizing matrices. And one of the homework problems had a matrix, a 2x2 matrix with ones on the diagonal and, you know, a one up in the corner and zero down below. And I couldn't diagonalize it, but I realized that I could put anything into that form if I couldn't diagonalize it. And I spent so long with 2x2 matrices and cataloging the ones that I couldn't diagonalize. And I went to my professor and just harassed him for hours until he finally explained Jordan canonical form to me. And that, I think, was when I became a mathematician. My general area of math is called algebraic combinatorics. And it's a fancy way of saying I like to count objects with special kinds of structures on them. And a nice example to kind of warm up to what am I trying to count? If I had a sheet of paper and I drew two lines on the paper, how many points are on both lines? And so you can think about that for a second. It's like, okay, well, probably the lines cross, and so there's one point. But I mean, I could have picked the same line twice. That would be silly, and there's infinitely many points. Or I could have done parallel lines, and there's no points. And so the first thing that algebraic combinatorics does is it sort of throws out those infinitely many or zero points. And we do that within constructions like projective space. Parallel lines meet in infinity. So, okay, they meet in a point. And then we do things like we talk about general position. Okay, don't pick the same line twice. That's silly. So we assume like some generic conditions, then okay, two lines meet in a point. So one, that's what I just counted. And now you can think a little more excitingly. You can say, okay, I'm in a room and I have four lines in space. How many other lines can touch all four of them? And this is something that I've actually done with kids. It's really fun. You get masking tape and you put up your lines. And you can put them in weird positions, and then you give the kids a broom. It's best if you only let one kid have a broom at a time. You give them a broom, and then they try to find, okay, how many ways can they make the broom touch all four pieces of tape at once? And they at first think that they can't do it. And so it's really fun when they realize that they can do it, and they can do it in two ways. And now if you want to think, okay, well, why two? Because it's really hard to visualize, but again, the tape super helps. But you can think about this. What if I put two lines behind me, okay, in the plane of the bookshelf, and let's let them intersect. And now let's put two lines on the ceiling. the plane of the ceiling and let them intersect. Well, now what have you got? Well, you've got that point of intersection up there and that point of intersection behind me. Two points make a line. There's your first line. And what about, what else? We've got the plane of the bookshelf spanned by those two lines and the plane of the ceiling. Those two planes intersect at the top corner of the room. So that's your second line. But then why is it always two? And how do I know I didn't get enough? So that's where the combinatorics comes in my mind. So this is called Schubert calculus. And it was studied in the mid-1800s by lots of people. And then Schubert sort of started really delving into it, and sort of Hilbert in the early 1900s called on mathematics to make this rigorous. And like Schubert said, if the answer in this particular case is two, the answer is always two, unless you did something silly like pick three lines to be coplanar. And Hilbert wanted us to make that rigorous. And so mathematics then took that geometric problem and made it algebraic using the theory of cohomology rings. So what is a cohomology ring? Well, instead of explaining that, I'll just say it turns this problem of intersections into a problem of multiplying. So combinatorics then takes over and says, ah, well, I'm going to represent these cohomology classes that I need to multiply by special polynomials that have properties. And when I multiply them, I think about that in some kind of structured way where I'm going to think about boxes and putting balls into boxes and how many ways can I do it? And that's what it comes down to for me. I'm at the bottom of this sort of reduction and I'm in the combinatorial game. And I'm like, okay, I want to understand the structure of how these things multiply. And somehow I've lost all connection with the geometry at this point. But the numbers that I'm getting are still the same numbers that are telling me those two lines. When I first came to graduate school in Berkeley, they have a preliminary exam, which you're supposed to pass as soon as you show up. And I just failed it spectacularly. And it was the first time I'd ever not just failed something, but not done exceptionally well at something. And that was a real struggle because it was sort of, oh, I've got to actually study. And I'd never studied. I didn't know what you needed to do to study something because everything came so naturally to me. So this was really a challenge. And I feel like that was kind of a make or break point for me, but I decided that I was just going to crush this exam. And so I learned more about the exam. I looked at past tests and eventually I did crush the exam and I didn't just eke by, but I solidly blew that one out of the water. And then I ended up teaching the workshop that helps prepare students for this because I had learned like exactly what they were looking for and exactly how to do it. And so I kind of turned it into like something that was a really negative experience when it happened. I turned it into something positive and helped other people to get past that hurdle in a positive and constructive way. So that was maybe my first challenge. But after that, when I, once you start succeeding in math and once you start writing papers and proving theorems, there's something really exciting, awesome about results that were unknown and now we know them. But there's also a stiff competition and there's a backlash. Sometimes other people wanted to prove that theorem. They didn't want you to prove that theorem. And other people had thought about that theorem and they'd get a little upset that you proved it. And I have definitely faced backlash from that. I think the way that I get through it though, is I have amazing collaborators and supporters who I can go to and grumble and complain. And they're like, well, you know, let the haters hate. We still have a beautiful theorem. And now math has a beautiful theorem. And I think having that support, that community of good people that I know and trust just kind of helps get past the unpleasantness that sometimes creeps up. I think that what I'm working on right now is what I'm proudest of. And I think that anytime you ask me this question, that's my answer, what I'm working on right now, because I'm always working on the thing that I think is the most exciting and the most interesting. And right now I'm working on this Schubert calculus problem and I'm collaborating with Nantel Bergeron. And I've been called an optimist, but maybe maybe that wasn't a compliment at the time, but I think we can do it. I think that we can solve this problem. Finally, it's been 150 years almost. And I feel like we're understanding the structures behind these numbers and where they come from and how to compute them. And it's building, you know, we're standing on the shoulders of all the people who came before us. And I feel like finally there's enough people, there are enough ideas that have culminated that we could maybe make this big breakthrough. I had an amazing support network in graduate school, and her name is Monica Vazirani. She was a postdoc at Berkeley when I was a graduate student. And I always recommend to students now, my big advice to anybody going to grad school is find a Monica. She was not my advisor. She was mathematically close to me, so we could have mathematical conversations. But she helped me with all of those soft skills, and she helped me with all of the other stuff that mounts up. And my advisor is fantastic. I worked under Mark Heyman, and he's brilliant, and the mathematics was amazing. But sometimes you need someone to ask other questions of, and to kind of help navigate the political spectrum of the career and like what comes next. And having someone who's not your advisor to talk with about this, and even, you know, as you hit roadblocks and your problem falls apart, having someone to call who's not your advisor, you know, first call that person. That was really amazing for me. And Monica has continued to help and support me throughout my career at every stage. Percy Diaconis I met when I was a postdoc at MSRI, and I was thrilled to be able to work with him on a project, and Kanan Sundararajan at Stanford as well. We worked on a couple of papers together, but Percy was more than just a collaborator. So as I was a postdoc and I was sort of finding my footing in math, one thing that Percy taught me that I love is I would meet him for coffee at Stanford, and then he would just find, he talks with everyone. So a physicist, a biologist, you know, somebody comes by and has coffee with us, and then Percy wants me to explain what I'm working on to them, and there's no paper and there's no chalkboard, and I just have to tell them in words that they can understand while drinking coffee. And what a brilliant skill. And I love that he helped me to kind of foster that. It's like, if you can't really just say it to somebody, then like, what are you doing? Like, you should understand it to the point where you can just say it to somebody, and that somebody should be as broad as possible. And I'm not saying I'm great at it, but I certainly am aware of that skill and the need for it. I think the greatest gift that you can give to mathematics or to any field is your way of thinking, your unique approach to solving problems that only you can give us. And I think that that's the key to moving all of sciences forward. We need as many different brains that think in different ways as we can get. And anyone who's willing to share their thoughts, share their process, and share their solutions with the world like this, that's amazing. And please do it.